to this first plenary session. The first plenary session is on Polanyian Marx, and those who have been here to the opening lecture yesterday might still remember that we've been discussing this issue already yesterday, and today we will have a bit more time to dive deeper into the connection. We have three speakers, and I very briefly introduce the speakers because I'm sure that you are familiar with their work and what they do, but I think it's more polite to introduce them a little bit. And we changed a bit the program, so Bob Jessop will go first, and then Kari Ulani-Levit will be second, and then third, and we still have, as we are already a little bit late, we have a very tight schedule, and it's me as a moderator who force people here to strictly do not talk longer than 20 minutes. So, nevertheless, I start very briefly by introducing Kari Ulani-Levit. She's Emerita Professor of Economics at McGill University in Montreal, and she works and worked on economic development and economic sovereignty. And one detail which I think is very important for her work is that she worked on the Caribbean and in the Caribbean region. She had several posts as visiting professor, for instance, at the University of West Indies, and she co-edited four volumes related to Caribbean economics. And she also holds an honorary doctorate by the University of the West Indies. And of course, she is here because she is, could say, the literary executor of her father's work. And she's very familiar, of course, with this work. Bob Jessop, he is a distinguished professor of sociology at the University of Lancaster, and of course he's well known, most known for his contributions to state theory, to Marxist state theory. In his state theoretical approach, he works of course with Marx, and I know from him that he learned German by reading Karl Marx's work. And he works also with Gramsci and with Poulantzas, and he developed his state strategic relational approach. And I just want to briefly give two notes on his works. Of course, the first and most important work on state theory was putting the capitalist states in his place. He further developed his state theory, and recently he's working on a cultural political economy, and he also published a book, Putting Culture in Its Place in Political Economy. Klaus Dörre, he's professor of sociology at Friedrich Schiller University in Jena. He's also the director of the research group, the German Science Foundation funded research group on post-growth society. I do not know how you translate it in English. We have English translation. Post-growth societies. Okay. Postwachstumsgesellschaften. He does a lot of work on unions, and recently in 2015 he edited together with Stefan Lesenik and Hartmut Rosa a book with the title Sociology, Capitalism and Critique. And in 2014 he published a special issue of the Journal for Entwicklungspolitik, JEP, Precarity and Social Disintegration, a Relational Concept. The three speakers are familiar with the theories of Polanyi and Marx, so I'm very much looking forward to their contribution to Polanyi and Marx, and I have the word to Bob Jessop.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction. see it? Yes. It's not deliberate that Polanyi is sandwiched between Marx. What I'm going to do is to present, let's see if this works, yes. To start, actually, not with Polanyi, my favourite state theorist is Poulantzas. If I sometimes say Poulantzas instead of Polanyi, I hope you'll forgive me, it just shows where I'm coming from. I'm going to start, in fact, not with Polanyi or with Marx, but with some ideas from the prison notebooks from Gramsci on what it means to want to take a critique. And the reason for that is that I believe that a lot of the critique of Polanyi and of Marx and the dialogue between them doesn't follow the protocols that Gramsci suggests for a good critique. I'm then going to subject Marx and Polanyi to a Gramscian critique and demonstrate the extent to which much of the work has completely misunderstood the differences between Polanyi and Marx, partly because of Polanyi's reading of Marx in terms of classical or orthodox Marxism rather than in terms of what Marx said. I'm then going to demonstrate some very strong similarities by looking first of all at Marx's work on the capitalist mode of production, then at Polanyi's work on substantive economics, compare their ideas about fictitious commodities, because they both believe in fictitious commodities, land, labour, power, money, and knowledge, I will argue. And if I get to the end, it will be limits of accumulation, and if I don't, the PowerPoint will be circulated on the website in any case, so you can catch up later or ask me to visit slides that I didn't manage to get to. So let's move on. Again, this is Gramsci on critique from the prison notebooks. You need to look at any individual work in terms of its location within the whole intellectual development of an author's multiform work. And these essential aspects of the element that have become stable and permanent and made part of his own thought. This is Gramsci's genderism, not mine. Distinctly, those elements and the discards, the things that people experimented with for a time and then gave up. And I'd like to add here that if you look at the difference between the theoretical development in Marx and Gramsci, Marx and Polanyi, there is a difference in their theoretical approach because there's a difference in their theoretical object. Marx often makes assumptions in early parts of his work that he relaxes later. And this is another way of thinking of discards. The assumptions that you make at the beginning, which you abandon later in your work. And I think this is one of the major sources of the misunderstanding of Marx's ideas about fictitious commodities. Research for the leitmotif, the developing rhythm of thought, matters more than just looking for casual affirmations and isolated aphorisms. And this relates to the two whatevers. Whatever Marx said is right, and whatever he didn't say is wrong, or the idea that if you read Marx, you can sooner or later find anything that he said to affirm any other proposition you like to make. And I'm not trying to read Marx in terms of casual affirmations and isolated aphorisms in order to show the similarities between Marx and Polanyi. And then finally, you have to show the most scrupulous accuracy, scientific honesty, and intellectual loyalty without any preconceptions, a priorism, or party pre. And I think this, again, is one of the difficulties when people read Marx and Polanyi. They tend to have a preference for one or the other, and read the other text in the light of their preference for Marx or for Polanyi. This is one of Marx's well-known statements, the beginning of Capital. Beginnings in science are always difficult. And he goes on later to say that theories begin to decompose when, to use Michael Polanyi's terms, they get canonized. They're no longer treated in critical and interpretive way. So let me compare Marx and Polanyi. I've got two slides that do the comparison. This PowerPoint, unfortunately, was prepared just in time. Some of you may have noticed me preparing it just in time. And it seems that Polanyi has flicked a little bit off to the right. That's not deliberate. That's just the function of the last-minute preparation. But I want to start out by saying that both of them adopt a very similar theoretical approach we can describe as critical realism, which involves asking the question, what must the world be like for some surprising phenomenon, an anomaly, or something else to have occurred? I think they're both critical realists, and we can be seeing that in the next slides, why I think that, but I would argue that Marx is a deeper critical realist than Polanyi, and that's not a criticism, it's merely an observation that the starting point for Polanyi's work does not require the degree of movement from abstract, simple to concrete, complex concepts that is necessary for Marx's theoretical project. The second is not in terms of, if you like, meta-theoretical approach or theoretical focus. It's clear that their theoretical objects, the types of typologies they produce, are very, very different. Marx is concerned, above all in Capital, with the analysis of modes of production, focusing on the capitalist mode of production, with a minor interest in pre-capitalist economic formations. You see that in the Brunnerisse and some other texts. Polanyi is quite explicit. He's not going to analyze modes of production because prior to capitalism, production is so heavily embedded in other forms of social relation. He's going to be dealing with modes of distribution. Talks about four: householding, reciprocity, redistribution, and markets. They both have a critical focus, but the critical focus of Marx is the critique of political economy. It is the critique of the categories that organize the capitalist mode of production as an organic totality and the impact of these categories on dynamics. If you think of the critique of theories of surplus value, if you think of Capital, above all, it's not just a critique of objective, extra-discursive categories, it's about the categories that actually organize, fetishize, mystify, disguise what's going on, but these also have real effects. What we have in Polanyi is also a critique, but it's a critique of market liberalism, a critique of the belief in disembedded free markets as the most efficient mechanism of distribution. And then their analytical focus is different as a result of that. What we get with Marx, and this is not often recognized, although the Germans knew it better than almost anybody else, but a few nods in the direction of Russians, such as Rubin, is offering a form analysis of the capital relation, which includes the effects of generalizing the commodity form to labor power, money, land, and the general intellect. They're a fictitious commodification, in other words. Polanyi's analytical focus is on substantive economics, with formal economics regarded as an ideological aberration that undermines the working of a self-protecting market society. So we have a very different approach in terms of modes of production, modes of distribution, different types of critical focus, different analytical foci, form analysis, substantive economics. What's their outermost analytical horizon? In other words, what is they thinking about at the end of the day? The world market as the presupposition of capital accumulation, presupposition and posit for the Hegelians, the integration of the world market as a unity of all contradictions, and Polanyi is interested in the disembedding of markets from pre-modern societies and their incomplete re-embedding into market society. So disembedding is only one moment. The next moment is the re-embedding of that which has been disembedded, the market economy in a market society. And the problem with market fundamentalism, the problem with market liberalism, it prevents or blocks, obstructs or undermines the re-embedding of that which was disembedded into a market society. Magnum opus, Das Kapital, but we all know that's incomplete. Whether there's three missing books or four missing books is important, but I draw very heavily on what I think is a wonderful book by Michael Leibovitz, Beyond Capital,
which is an attempt to write the missing book on labour power. And it's absolutely clear there in that effort that Marx fundamentally saw labour power as a fictitious commodity, not as a commodity. And I'll give some reasons for that later. The Great Transformation, just in economic origins of our times. The opening problem, I said the critical realists begin with the question, what has the world been like for X to happen? The opening paragraph in Marx, Capital, Volume 1, is why does wealth in societies or social formations dominated by the capitalist mode of production take the form of an immense accumulation of commodities? For Polanyi, the opening paragraphs of why did 19th century civilization collapse? He cites four pillars for that, and then focuses on the self-regulating market. So they're both operating in a retroductive way with a particular problem, and then going to move on from that to present the rest of the work. I've only mentioned the magna opera. I haven't mentioned the other work. And when we're comparing Polanyi and Marx, you need to be able to compare like with like, which is why I said yesterday that if we want to compare Polanyi with Marx, we better not compare Polanyi with Capital Volume 1, although you can find some interesting things on poor law, factory legislation, worker struggles, primitive accumulation through dispossession and so forth. You'd have to compare the historical works of the one with the historical works of the other. And finally, we need to recognize they've got very different starting points in their analyses. Marx starts with the point that the commodity is the elementar form, the elementary form of the capital relation. He also refers to it as the kind form, the germ form, and to the zellen form, the cell form. And what he's going to do with the form analysis is to analyze how different sets of social relations acquire the form of a commodity without necessarily becoming direct commodities in their own right. Market fundamentalism, on the other hand, is the starting point for Polanyi. So you can see that if we're not careful, we're not going to be comparing one project with another project as if they are identical. My point is, the projects are very different, but they have implications for the sorts of issues that we want to discuss today. How am I doing for time? Sorry, dear.
5 minutes.
5 minutes, right. That's going to set the cat among the pigeons, as we say in England. Capitalist mode of production, and you're going to have to catch up with that later. But this is the way in which Marx sets out his understanding of the capitalist mode of production, starting with wealth, the commodity form, and so forth. But we won't deal with that. We'll focus on the two special commodities which are mentioned in Capital, Volume 1, Chapter 4. In a world where wealth takes the form of the immense accumulation of commodities, there are two special forms of commodity. Labour power, which has a price, but is not yet produced within a competitive capitalist labour process for sale. And money, the universal commodity or generalised medium of exchange that can be used to buy all other commodities. Marx starts out with the assumption that money is gold. It is a commodity. He very rapidly moves beyond that to look at the capitalist credit relation, and then it's not a commodity, it's a fictitious commodity. Is labour power a commodity? There's a long argument there, but that's the quick answer. If it was a commodity, it would be produced in this way, in capitalist conditions of production, to get labour power reproduced with a socially minimum necessary labour time to get labour power into the market as quickly as possible. Marx does not believe in the brave new world. He believes that labour power has to be conformed, bullied, pushed, subjectivated, and so forth in order to work within the labour process. The same argument we get in Marx, we get in Polanyi as well, that only when all of the inputs into the capitalist production and distribution process take the form of commodities, can you get the operation of the capitalist mode of production. And this is just a slide about money as a social relation It's a commodity and a fictitious commodity. As gold, it's a commodity dug out of the ground, socially necessary labour time. But in terms of credit relations, fictitious credit, fictitious capital, it is fictitious. Marx on the functions of money, let's get with that. Let's go to Polanyi. We don't want to leave him out, sandwiched between two sets of Marx's work, but he's in the centre, at least. What Polanyi is focusing on is not form analysis, but substantive economics. The substantive economy is the instituted process of interaction between man and his environment, which results in a continuous supply of want-satisfying material means. Human economy is embedded and meshed in institutions and so forth. This is the hierarchy of concepts in Polanyi, and you can see that what Marx is interested in is really sort of exchange-based, market-mediated economies. I sometimes describe capitalism as profit-oriented, market-mediated accumulation. There is a lot that Polanyi discusses in substantive economic terms, which is only Marx's interests. And then we have laissez-faire, and we have even then the distinction between re-embedded liberalism and unregulated liberalism. This is the strong risk of the economistic fallacy on the right-hand side, whereas for Marx, the economistic fallacy is an important part of his whole approach to critique of political economy. Substantive modes of distribution, no time to go through that, but there they are, householding, reciprocity, redistribution, market. The market economy, a market economy can exist only in a market society. It must comprise all elements of industry, including labor, land, and money. Commodities empirically defined as objects produced for sale on the market. So, and you'll find there, in fact, essentially the same as Marx says, only when all of the inputs into the capitalist mode of production take the form of commodities do you get profit-oriented, market-mediated accumulation. You get the same argument exactly in Polanyi. Fictitious commodities, again, I would argue exactly the same in Marx, is that with the help of this fiction, markets for labour, land and money are organised. Vital organizing principle, treating labor, land, and money as if they were commodities has real effects. Their demand, supply, and price are real magnitude. Pure Marx, they just don't realize it because of the ways in which Polanyi chooses to read Marx. I'll give you just one example from the great transformation. Polanyi attributes to Marx a Ricardian theory of money as a commodity. That's only the starting assumption of capital and not the end point in capital. Knowledge is a fictitious commodity. This in red are the factors that Polanyi talks about, land, labour, power exchange. A little nod in the direction of also Michael Polanyi, who has interesting things to say on knowledge, but not in a Karl Polanyian sense. And these are the ways in which, and this is in the red there, the way that Polanyi deals with the fictitious commodities. What I'm trying to do here is to show there's a lot more besides that Polanyi misses out and isn't always there in Marx either. But we can get towards Marx at the end, who talks about fictive capital. Double movement. I think I'm through in 2 minutes, so you'd be one. That's good. Yes, that was that way round, not that way round. Good. The double movement of society fights back against commodification of labour, land, and money with different forces in different ways. Extension of the market organisation in relation to commodities does accompany by its restriction in relation to fictitious ones. Okay, that's fundamental to how you can embed a market economy in a market society, and it would be one of the principles I would use in trying to think of an alternative. This is resistance, and this is where I think I want to disagree with the idea that all Marx talks about is class struggle. We have primitive accumulation of capital that's resisted by peasants in relation to land, by craft workers, guild workers in relation to the commodification of labour power. There's an awful lot of work done in order to force workers into the labour market, and when workers are resisting proletarianisation, are they engaged in class struggle within the capital relation, or are they resisting the capital relation? We know that the commodity form generalises. We heard yesterday about academic capitalism, and that involves various forms of extension of economising logic. And what we see is the typical actors are not always classes, but they are nonetheless engaged in resisting the market economy. Conclusions. Marx and Falange adopted different theoretical and analytical approaches, but they had different historical concerns. Falange's opening question, you can look at the screens over there as well. Falange's opening question was, what must the world be like for 19th century civilization that collapsed? How it did, and this is Karl Falange pointing his finger, telling us, I told you I was right about market liberalism, and this is the last part. Marx's opening question was, what must the world be like for wealth and capitalist mode of production to take the form of the immense accumulation of commodities? Marx, what I told you I was right about capitalism. So Polanyi is right about market liberalism. Marx is right about capitalism. They are compatible in many interesting and significant ways, and even more compatible if you read Marx through a form analytical perspective rather than a substantive economics perspective. And I've exhausted myself, I've exhausted you.
Yeah, Carrie.
I have to begin by telling you how I find it difficult to put into words how happy I am to be here on this occasion. If I even had heard of a conference in Linz on the work of Karl Falange, I would be happy to have heard about it. But to actually be able to be here is quite wonderful. It's not the first conference we've had in Austria on the work of Karl Falange, because we did, some 20 years ago, organize a much more modest conference in Vienna. And at that time, I was here for 6 weeks in preparation for that conference. And I think I must, as I remember it, pay tribute to the Austrian colleague who was principal in organizing that, and it was the late Egon Matzner. And he was in charge of a very small unit of the University of Vienna called, I think, socioeconomics or social economics, that existed under the shadow of a much more powerful but more conventional economics department. And at that time, he was a co-author of a little book with Amit Bhadari and Jan Kregel on, it was called Market Shock. It was 1994. It was the beginning of the efforts to introduce the instant capitalism, instant market system in the former Soviet Union, and it was a very, at that time, an important critique of that policy. So now we are meeting, and it is 22 years later, and we could not be talking about Karl Falange and the Great Transformation at a more appropriate time. I don't have to remind you of that, because we listened to some of that on Monday evening. This extraordinary phenomenon of right-wing populism that has swept across the Western world. Speaking of the Western world, the topic of our conference here has to do with Polanyi's work on a global transformation, I think we do have to remind ourselves from time to time that this Western world, Europe, North America in particular, historically speaking, is relatively on the decline in terms of the whole wide world and the relative rise of Asia. And I'm not going to speak about that, but I do think we have to bear in mind that most of what we say pertains to our part of the world, which is, as I say, the Western world. And I don't think, I think some talk is too glib in terms of using this word global to imagine that many of the institutions that we know here and the world we know is simply being globalized and enlarged to embrace all the rest of the world, because so let me begin perhaps by talking a little about the book, The Great Transformation. Very recently, five lectures written by, given by Karl Polanyi in the year 1940 on the topic of the present transformation. The transformation was taking place currently, I suppose, in 1940. He had arrived in the United States and been invited to Bennington. And in these lectures, I find so interesting because they outline the reasons why he believed that the 19th century liberal order had collapsed in the era between the First and Second World War. But because they were lectures and written very simply, the major thesis of the book, and certainly the contents of its first two chapters, appear very bold and very clear. And I'd like to share with you two or three observations from a reading of these lectures. The first one itemizes the manifestations of the transformation, which happened, according to him, very suddenly at the beginning of the 1930s. They are the termination of the gold standard by Britain, followed by other countries, and this is the order in which they appear. They are the adoption of five-year plans in the Soviet Union, including the agricultural sector. They are the New Deal in the United States. They are then what he calls the revolutionary national socialism of Germany, of course, and then a variety of authoritarian and autarkic, that is economically closed, fascist solutions in East or South Europe. And then he says, well, when we look at the variety of societies, of countries, of places that have been struck by this change, this transformation, and I suppose the variety, including the New Deal in the United States, the adoption of economic planning, in the Soviet Union, a country which was at that time still largely agricultural, peasant country, and then the National Socialism, he said there must be one unifying external cause that has operated and has affected the history of Europe and of North America in this way, and he identified it as the liberal economic order, in other words, the capitalist market economy. Incidentally, in this in these lectures, he uses the words capitalism and market economy interchangeably, as I think he does in The Great Transformation and in his later writings. There is then a very important second lecture in which he points out the problem of what he called the self-regulating market, in the way in which that capitalist market system had taken over and had forced upon the society its requirements, its rules, its modus of operating, and thereby creating a market society, and the need to reintegrate politics and economics. I'm not going further into details. The next very interesting lecture is on the conditions of the United States, which, on the basis of his several previous visits there, he recognized as being basically different from the European experience, and therefore able to make adjustments to the breakdown of the capitalist order, the Great Depression, without sacrificing democracy. The argument he gave for that was that in the United States, the national state, the federal state, Washington, was historically quite weak and really only became important in the 1930s with the New Deal, and there was no conflict of the kind that created the fascist solutions in Europe. Very interesting. You know, out of these lectures, I have committed to memory only one line. Because as many of you know, I can't see, so I don't have a text, and I can't read anything. But there was a sentence that I thought was important in terms of our present situation in this discussion. And it was that he said, the modern nation is a protective reaction to the to dangers emanating from an interdependent world. That was the interdependence in his case had to do really with the gold standard and the very rigid way in which the that monetary financial system created world markets. Incidentally, he pointed out, and I think it's good to remember, that there really is no such thing as a world market. We talk about world market, global market, but they are really national markets that are coordinated together by some by capital movements and monetary movements and by trade, of course. So let me come to what is supposed to be the topic here, relationship Polanyi and Marx. And I'd like to tell you that I think that my father encountered Marx in England when he arrived there in the 1930s. Of course, like all well-educated Europeans, he knew of Marx, and he had read Capital, at least volume one. But I think his real encounter with Marx came in England, and came because both of them, when studying the origins of capitalism, in this case, if you wish, the origins of the fictitious commodities, in the case of Marx, the origins of capitalism in the early English Industrial Revolution, read very much the same text as can be seen from what Polanyi read when he had to give lectures for 3 years on the English social economic history to to adult education to workers, because he was employed in adult education. And what Marx read, you can see in the Lunaris, very much the documents of the era, of the writings of Malthus and Ricardo and other writers of that period. But when I say that for my father, in England was his third and most important encounter with Marx, it really was not the encounter with Marx that made the impression on him as much as the encounter with capitalism in England in the 1930s. It was a profound culture shock, as it had been for Marx when he first came 100 years before to England and saw the conditions of the working class. So well described by his friend Engels in his famous book. Marx was shocked at the conditions of the working people, working class. And 100 years later, when my father came to England in the 1930s, he was shocked at the condition of the working class in England in the 1930s, which he compared unfavorably with the conditions of workers in Vienna in the 1920s, so-called Red Vienna, which I remember very well because that was the Vienna of my childhood.
Five minutes?
Yeah. Oh my goodness. Well, I... 5 minutes. I believe that Marx then... Marx went to study the English political economists. Yes, what I want to say is that in my opinion, Marx was the first economist of industrial capitalism. The previous political economy, especially of Ricardo, which he used, he took from Ricardo the labor theory of value, he took from Ricardo in many ways the idea of surplus. But I've lost my train of thought. Just one moment.
First economist of industrial capitalism.
Thank you. First economist of industrial capitalism. Because what Marx discovered was capital. Capital. No, what capital had been before that, it was a sum of money to be lent at interest. It was a stock of goods of the merchant. That was his capital, was the goods he took around with him. But for Marx, capital became something else. It became the active agent of production. In the capitalist mode of production, capital is the driving agent, because the capital has to produce the surplus and it has to realize it by finding markets in which these things can be sold, and so the process continues. And the system is driven by the requirements of capital. I kind of have neither the time, nor is this the opportunity to elaborate further. But the market that Polanyi sees as spreading all over the globe is the same market that Marx described in the Communist Manifesto, or for that matter, particularly in the Grundriss, where he traces the fact that over the time, goods are produced of increasing sophistication, requiring consumers, of increasing wants, until at the end of the day, maybe all the goods will be produced by machinery. And the displaced workers will have a relatively high level of proficiency in education. And that brings me to more or less where I believe we are moving today. And I would like to put on the table here for discussion, I don't have time, a subject that directly arises from Marx's reflections in the Grundrisse of the possibility of a world in which commodities are produced by machines and workers only just mine them, in his view, that would be liberation, the step from necessity to freedom. But another way of looking at it, this looks to be like a possibility of a world that is very problematic, in which a minority, perhaps 20% of people, are employed and work and very highly qualified in the production of digital information technology, and a large number are increasingly not required for employment, living precariously or not employed at all. And that's really, if you want, my main concern, as I am an economist and a political economist, and I would like perhaps on another occasion to talk to you about how it was that Keynes in 1930s thought that his grandchildren would live in a world of sufficiently high GDP where people could have to work only 15 hours a day and live a good life. And then since that time, we have had a huge increase in economic growth, and people work today, if anything, even longer than they did in those days. And I want to leave you with a problem which really does not compare Polanyi with Marx, because in my mind is with this problem, which is a prediction by the late Vasily Leontief, who made it 30 years ago in the early 1980s, of a world in which 20% of the people, as I say, are highly trained and very well paid and producing information technology, and 80% are redundant to the system. And if it were true that socialism required a certain level of production, the techniques of production as used to be thought or is thought by people in the Marxist tradition, then we are moving toward that situation, and we do have sufficient technology to produce everything that is basically required. And so we have to think of how our societies can be organized in a different way. And finally, I'm sorry, finally there is the issue of competition. I just want to leave you with that thought, that is, the commodities, fictitious or otherwise, are competing. And there is a general idea that competition is somehow good, or monopolies are certainly bad. But I think that the main point of Polanyi's story is the negative and undesirable and socially destructive aspects of competition, whether in obviously in the labor market, that's why we have unions, but also more generally in life, and to look at cooperation. Thank you for giving me the extra time.
Firstly, to Marx, as you know, all history is a history of class struggles. Marx himself, however, never presented a comprehensive theory of class, nor do we find fully developed political economy of labor capable of a systematic understanding of class struggles and class movements in his writings. Classes and class relations are important categories in Polanyi's work as well. He rejects, however, the economistic understanding of classes he believes to be inherent in Marx's thinking. To Polanyi, class interests offer only a limited explanation of long-run movements in society, as class-specific sectional interests must be ultimately related to a total situation. Furthermore, class interests most directly refer to standing and rank, to status and security, that is, they are primarily not economic but social. According to Polanyi, an overly narrow conception of class is bound to lead a warped vision of social and political history, because it ignores that purely economic matters are far less central to the actions of a class than questions of social recognition. I, for my part, maybe you are surprised about this, consider Polanyi's argument to be quite plausible. If we proceed from a concept of class as Marx develops in the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte, however, we find many similarities to Polanyi. This all is more true when we are reading Marx and Polanyi through the lens of Antonio Gramsci and this theory of hegemony, the commonalities between both class conceptions can be summarized as follows. Classes as such, I have some problems with my eyes and so it's difficult for me to read the text. Classes as such can never act as they are homogeneous collective subjects. Only the organizations and representatives of different classes can act. Although class-specific inequalities may be central to conflict dynamics in a given society, this needn't necessarily be the case. History is also the history of non-class-specific movements against the satanic mill of the market. Ethnic and gender-based axes of inequality, for example, cannot be explained with recourse to class inequality alone, although they certainly contain a class-specific dimension. Class consciousness is far more likely to be found among the ruling classes. By contrast, the normal state of most subaltern classes, class fractions, is characterized by competition, fragmentation, atomization, and division. This situation can be overcome if the corresponding forms of social interaction and relations of communication allow for a mobilization of members of class. The decisive factors of this process are experience and processes of education, which facilitate a conscious overcoming of habitualized practices geared towards constant competition. Class action essentially seeks to improve individual or collective positions within the social space. The transition from individual to collective organized class action is contingent on many factors, and the phenomenon of revolutionary class action is an absolute exception. Due to extensive state political regulatory functions, even this type of class action corresponds to a kind of class semantics in only the rarest of cases. Hegemonic social blocs are always of a cross-class nature. Furthermore, classes only exist as a process. They are influenced by political ideological cycles. It is therefore likely that phases of destructuring and reforming of classes alternate throughout the course of history. Characteristic of the current debate is my second point. Namely, many authors cite Polanyi as the chief critic of market radicalism without even the slightest mention of the category of class. Polanyi is viewed as the forefather of a critique of capitalism that proceeds from the socially destructive consequences of disembedded markets as opposed to exploitation in the labor process itself. This understanding is also reflected in the classification of social movements. Movements of the Polanyian type are directed against an expansive economic market force that appears vague and abstract. Rarely can it be clearly identified, and criticism against it can be politicized in more than one direction. Movements against the market, such as the early socialist labor movement, may indeed pursue system-transcending objectives. It is also entirely possible, however, that they simply demand increased protection from the market-mediated competition. It's also possible that they begin to exhibit reactionary nationalist or, as in the case of the fascist mobilizations, even terrorist characteristics. It was the argument of Michael yesterday, and it's my argument too. In contrast of the implications of Marxian class universalism, which assumed that the exploitation of the world market would give a cosmopolitan character to production and consumption in every country, Polanyi considers it just as likely that the exact opposite will occur, arguing that the leveling market power could reinforce an endemic tendency among wage earners to draw non-class borders and boundaries as a basis for claims for protection from the maelstrom of the market. It is doubly so, yes. I follow her with this argument. If we follow this distinction, it is thirdly easy to label various movements in the early 21st century as movements of the Polanyian type. This is also true, I would argue, for the imaginary revolt of the contemporary ethno-nationalist right populism. The latter enjoys considerable support around male workers. In Germany, for example, the right populist Alternative für Deutschland won a plurality, a majority of votes among male workers in all of the 2016 regional elections. Moreover, it has been receiving substantial support from trade union members. If we look for the causes of this development, we come across, fourthly, a problematic which in fact neither Marx nor Polanyi devoted adequate attention to. Far more promising in this regard is Pierre Bourdieu, or more recently Didier Eribon, based on the example for semi-skilled workers who were once loyal communist voters but no supportive Front National. Eribon, in his brilliant book, Returning to Rennes, demonstrates very clearly that classes take effect even in the absence of political class mobilization. In this case, they manifest through negative classifications. Distinct competitive classes emerge as the result of a collective social de- and revaluation. Underclasses whose members live below the threshold of respectability, for example, are the creation of collective debasement through other working classes. This can be observed in the empirically verifiable consciousness of wage laborers in the export economy, not only in Germany. In fact, radical criticism of society and capitalism were surprisingly popular among the wage laborers in the automotive industry we studied. This critique is primarily the result of a perceived distributional injustice. At the same time, it reflects the threat posed to the natural basis of life by a ruthless profit economy. The rectification of class-specific injustices and inequalities in favor of wage earners, however, seems impossible or only barely possible, both structurally and subjectively. The more inescapable systemic market imperatives seem, and the more unlikely the attenuation of class-specific distributional injustices, however modest, appears, the more likely it becomes that the core workforce will concentrate on defending the status quo. A spontaneous tendency towards exclusive solidarity is where the right populists deploy their reinterpretations of the everyday critique of the market and of capitalism. Right populist mobilizations succeed because class-specific inequalities are successfully reinterpreted as a fight for the wealth of the people, not between the top and the bottom of society, not between the impoverished and the wealthy, but instead between the inside and outside, between the German people, for example, and the alleged migrant invaders, so-called migrant invaders. Fifthly, the absence of political philosophies capable to responding effectively to right populism constitutes a fundamental problem not only of trade unions, I would say, for the whole political left today. The predicament of course related to the fact that class categories have largely disappeared from the public discourse in Europe. The young academic intelligentsia as well as journalists in the leading media have for the most part lost touch with the subaltern classes. Political party researcher Wolfgang Nagel argues that the left has cosmopolitanized itself, shifted its political focus to the cultural sphere. This loss of communication between classes is on a massive scale, and it's a problem for social justice. Essentially, a new class society has emerged in the shadow of the left's growing cultural sensibility. And this class society is not a topic of young intellectual discourse, at least thus far. I would add to this observation that continental Europe today consists of demobilized class societies. Class-specific inequalities and closures are on the rise, while class movements or organized class politics from below are weak. Bearing this in mind, we find simply a conceptual weakness in Polanyi, or at least in the currently dominant reception of his work. As illuminating as Polanyi's analysis of the fictitious commodities of labor, land capital, maybe it tells us little about the systemic driving forces underlying the expansive principle of market and competition. Because Polanyi does not specify the drivers of the market-driven double movement in detail, the starting points for counter-movements also remain analytically imprecise. A vague critique of the market is unable to identify causal mechanisms capable of synchronizing the obstinate day-to-day consciousness of wage laborers in the sense of a democratic transformation of mechanisms of the capitalist society. According to Polanyi's argument, the class interests of the subaltern are structured by the overarching societal interests and social value orientations. At the present time, at least as far as members of core workforces are concerned, company and workplace related identifications appears to relativize wage laborers' socially critical consciousness. This is one of the reasons why a vague, aimless anti-capitalism often finds its political home in the new right populist camp. This glaring absence of communication and interaction between oppositional classes, class currents cannot be overcome with a theoretical toolkit that limits itself to a critique of the market competition and growth. To address this gap, I propose consider bringing Polanyi and Marx closer together once again. This critical anthropology of Polanyi is easily linked to an understanding of capitalism informed by Marx. In this sense, the expansive excess of the entire ensemble of human labor activities characteristic of contemporary capitalism makes it painfully clear to workers that labor is only another name for a human activity which goes with it, with life itself, which in its turn is not produced for sale, but for entirely different reasons. From this observation arises seventhly an exploitation problematic that goes beyond the private appropriation of valorized gainful labor of encompass the entire ensemble of autonomous and reproductive activities. The compulsion to live from the scale of one's labor power and deploy that labor power in flexible modes of production structures all other labor capacities. These include unpaid care work, self-directed labor, and all voluntary activities geared towards personal development. The various distinct labor capacities must be linked to labor capacities, in German it's Arbeitsvermögen, I don't know if it's the right English term. Yeah. Distinct labor capacities must be linked to another through coordinating or navigational labor. I have no idea. Navigational labor, Steuerungsarbeit, it's a term of Alexander Kluge and Oskar Nick. Perhaps coordinating labor, yeah. The new exploitation problematic is rooted in the fact that additional hours of often unpaid navigational or coordinating labor are needed to coordinate the various labor capacities. Oskar Nick and Alexander Kluge speak of a balanced imperialism that operates via the withdrawal of coordinating energies. This occupation of all human labor capacities is a result of the systemic drive of capital to reproduce itself on an expanding scale to increase labor productivity and earnings, all for the sake of multiplying capitalist property. Polanyi teaches us that this expansive tendency is not some kind of natural law. It was and continues to be the outcome of a conscious and often violent intervention on the part of government and state, which imposed the market organization on society for non-economic ends. The enforcement of market imperatives, however, also implies that applies the kind of accumulation, exploitation, and class division we find in Marx. And an understanding of exploitation that takes the expansive navigational or coordinating imperialism into account would necessarily go beyond both Marx and Polanyi. On such a basis, we could perhaps reanimate, it's only one opportunity, Walter Korpi's concept of a democratic class struggle, but it's a concept only for the organized labor power in the global north and not for the disorganized labor power in the global south. We have to think about what Beverly calls labor unrest and so on. But the concept of democratic class struggle refers to a struggle fought on the basis of wage earners' inalienable economic and social rights, regardless of how intense these struggles may become. In short, what we need is a theoretical and political foundation for a new national as well as transnational class-specific collective. Such an identity can only emerge out of common struggle and experience. For research on this topic, we need both Marx and Polanyi, and more important, we need our own heads to interpret a new reality beyond Marx and Polanyi. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for the three rich presentations, and excuse myself for being rude for interrupting the food. So we have now about 20 minutes time. We started a bit late, so I've eat a little bit of a lunch break, and I'd like to open the floor for questions, for remarks to the three presentations. I could go into, I would say, different angles, either more conceptual, discussing about the concept which came up in the presentations, and of course the other strand would then be how to discuss recent developments with Marx and the Polanyi, or going beyond the two thinkers. So, and I would like to ask you to present yourself and tell us to whom you would address your question. Yes, please.
Yes, I want to start from Bob Jessop's talking about a distinction between that reciprocity is a category of consumption, or I don't think so. I think it's a concept both of consumption and of production. And this is important because I think, as was discussed here, the anthropology, I mean, it's extremely important in his later writing, in Polanyi's later writing. I talk about this triangle, the Polanyian triangle of production, of human production, with reciprocity being the first form, 300,000 years old, and then distribution, 5,000 years old, and then market, 2,500 years old. So I think when we're talking about the future and bringing together different labor capacities, as was discussed in the last intervention, I think this idea of reciprocity taking a much bigger part of life. Of course, I think we can keep market for certain things, and of course distribution and state is extremely important. But lots of the new forms of labor actually takes part outside and in the reciprocity. In the sort of Wikipedia, for instance, this is an incredibly big reciprocal production of very important. And you can see it in very many modern industries, that even though they are on the market, the research behind it, etc., is reciprocal. So I think the concept of reciprocity needs to be, the Polanyian concept discussed, for instance, in the 1957 book, is extremely important and has a future dimension. Okay, sorry, that's enough.
Thanks. I have several more questions, and I take another one. Do you have a microphone?
Thank you. My name is Sarima Valiani. I'm based in Johannesburg, South Africa. I have a question for Pari. Could you please elaborate on two points that you made? One, that our use of the word global tends to be quite glib. And the final question that you put, which I think is related, around 80% of the world being quite excluded from the global system of production, you could say. Please comment also on the way Polanyi and or Marx tried to address that question. I think Marx did it a little bit better than Polanyi, but both are quite Eurocentric. Please elaborate on that, and I hope I can also do the same thing tomorrow in my presentation at 4:30 on modification.
I'll pass the word to you first.
It's just a misunderstanding of my presentation. I was saying that Marx's theoretical focus was on modes of production, that Polanyi rejects a focus on production because he says we can't then deal with situations where the economy is not institutionally separate from the wider society and therefore produced a typology of modes of distribution. And the table that I presented was a table drawn from, Polanyi didn't use PowerPoint slides, but I turned his argument into a PowerPoint slide and I was simply presenting the definitions that Polanyi offers for his modes of distribution. One can then certainly do, as you do and I've done in my work, talk about the relative weight of different modes of distribution as they exist at the moment and so forth. And I also agree with you, and it's a Polanyian point, that if we want to organize a more just society, then we need to put markets in their place, and we could limit the role of markets in fictitious commodities, but markets have their functions within a broader, more solidaristic, more reciprocal system. So I think you simply misunderstood, as I galloped through my presentation, and you know, anybody who misunderstands me can use that as their excuse. And it's a perfectly legitimate excuse as well.
Yes. Let me start with the first point you raised, the use of the word global. You know, I think we have to understand that language matters. And the neoliberal project brought with it a whole new vocabulary, and what of which global is an example. When global is used instead of international, the nation appears from you. It disappears. And it appears as if there are truly, as if national boundaries don't exist. Both those advocates of globalization and many of the opponents seem to forget that nations not only exist, but continue to be, in my opinion, and in the opinion of Guy Polanyi actually, very important social and political entities which have the capacity to make laws, etc., and to negotiate. So when global is substituted for international, something disappears. Secondly, there is a whole hierarchy of what can happen globally. Obviously, money is the most globalized of all categories. Capital somewhat less so, because it's subject to more restrictions. People, of course, are certainly not mobile globally, easily. So I think it is important to understand that nations and policies formulated at the national level continue to be extremely important, in fact, basic. The next question, could you remind?
About the 18%.
Oh, yes. You know, very interestingly, the most recent reference to this 20% was made very recently by Noriel Rubini. I don't know if you remember this name, but he was called Dr. Doom, yes, because he understood the crisis of 2007 and 8, and he foresaw it and explained it. But in any event, he made a toast at a celebration hosted by Bloomberg of the microchip as the most disruptive single appearance in the last 80 years. He elaborated again on the rise of information technology and particularly artificial intelligence in terms of its ability to disrupt and change social and economic relations and the possibility and definitely the dystopia of a society. in which you made the what's that place in California again?
Silicon Valley.
Silicon Valley, and everything it represents in terms of the corporate interests and the glorification of the technology and the science begin to rule the world. and 80% of people in a similar reference made by Leontief 30 years earlier are going to be like the horses that were put out to graze when they were not needed anymore in farming or in transportation. This is of course a huge exaggeration, but I think it is very important. It is important in the sense that what we are seeing and witnessing is a massive displacement of industrial workers by technology. There is one statistic produced by the University of Chicago study that from the millennium to more or less recent times, one half of all the manufacturing jobs in the United States that disappeared were lost to technology. The rest, I suppose, were just lost to import competition from cheaper Chinese and other goods. So we begin to have what Marx pictured in his thought experiment in the Grundriss, labor that is no longer required in production of increasingly higher qualifications and skills. We can think of PhDs driving taxis. It is not unknown at the moment, only from foreign countries, immigrants, but it's going to be at least in the United States and Canada also our local young people. I think those were the two questions. And in fact, I finally want to add only one more, because I have a huge respect for Leontief. I spent many years doing these input-output studies and things like that. So, and I knew him personally also, a very remarkable person. And he said that the kind of social and economic and political changes and cultural changes that will be required in our world as a result of the microchip and information technology are on the same scale as those that happened in the Industrial Revolution in the early 19th century. And that is something to think about as we are looking at the whole world of work and labor and society.
Thank you. My name is Michele Cantani. I was very interested in all the presentations, but I would only propose a question to Bob Jessop. The question is, maybe there are some similarities between Polanyi and Marx, showing that they are closer to each other than it was possible to understand from your presentation. I don't want to cite many references in Polanyi of Marx's works. One could be the 11 theses on Feuerbach, which are fundamental from the point of view of Polanyi's own political philosophy. But I don't want to deal with this point. And also another point I can also only hint to it, because times, but the other problem is the question of the critique of political economy and Polanyi's reading of the first chapter of Capital. I think that and Polanyi have basically the same concern in defining different forms of societies. And this is the problem of critical political economy, beyond the interest of political economists for the prices and so on. And it is what Marx wants to reveal through the analysis of the form of the exchange and so on. And the same is true about Polanyi, when he distinguishes the formal and the substantive definition of the economy. He understands substantive in the Aristotelian sense of something, a quality which is essential to define something. And he wants simply define, give a really general definition of the economy. Contrasting it with the formal definition, which is simply a reflection of a particular form of the economy, that is a market capitalist economy. And it defines the formal definition as a logical error, in the sense that an element of the set is understood as the definition of the set itself.
Sorry to interrupt you, but
This is an important point, because this means that Polanyi wants not only to define liberal Victorian capitalism, but also capitalism in general, and the great transformation can be read through this double level of abstraction, capitalism in general as compared with the pre-modern forms of production and 18th century liberal capitalism.
Thank you. There is one more question behind, and then there is another.
Thank you. My name is Paolo Mazzocchia. I'm from the University of Macerata in Italy. My question is somewhat related to what the gentleman was saying. It has to do with the difference between Marx and Polanyi concerning their view of capitalism. If I have to rely on the last pictures, Polanyi was right about what he said about liberalism.
Marxism,
yes. Whereas Marx was right about capitalism. I would tend to ask you, what can we say about labor as a fictitious commodity in the two authors? In other words, if Polanyi is a critic of market liberalism, if we re-embed capitalism, we would be basically decommodifying labor, and we would be solving the fictitious commodity problem in Polanyi. Whereas in Marx, since labor would still be subsumed to the capitalist mode of production, it would still be a commodity. Is that right?
Thank you. Your question?
Hi, I'm Adrian. Good morning. I'm aware that this is a scientific conference, and I'm also aware that this is quite a fully loaded question. But I was wondering, when you were talking about the ordinary consciousness of the worker, and we are talking about all those fictitious commodities and all those things, how can we bridge our language, which we have at the moment, with, you know, people on the ground, with practitioners, and yeah, basically.
So this was more a question to the three on the panel. I take a very final question, please.
Mm-hmm. What are we
Okay, when we take Gramsci as a lens in understanding Polanyi and Marx, what is our appropriation of the counter-movements and the double movements that were discussed and our take on the war of position versus the war of maneuver, and how viable is this in Europe at this point in time?
Yeah, thank you. So I think there are questions for three of you. Charles, do you want to start? Or?
I think most of the questions are questions for...
Okay, for Bob.
Yeah. Again, I think we need to distinguish between the text, the words, the concepts. I just skimmed through The Great Transformation. There are six references to Marx. There are a lot more references to Marxism. The references to Marxism are generally uncomplimentary. The references to Marx aren't that complimentary either, because they accuse him of being economistic, they accuse him of a Ricardian theory of commodity money, they accuse him of thinking only homo economicus, and so forth. And if you looked at the surface of the texts, you're not going to find very much that's in common. If you look at the underlying conceptual logics, you're going to find a great deal of similarity, and that was the point of my introducing Gramsci at the beginning. You can't read the words, you can't read the specific references, you have to look at the logic of the text. And my argument is that the logic of the text, the Great Transformation, you find very many similarities. And I think they must almost be accidental rather than deliberate, in the sense that they're both concerned with broadly the same problems. They're both concerned with the emergent crisis tendencies of a particular period and so forth, and they're coming to similar conclusions because, against any superficial readings, they share the views that land, labour power and money are fictitious commodities and not real commodities. I think, too, it's very difficult. If you only read chapter 1 of Capital, volume 1, you're going to come up against the problem that I referred to, that assumptions are made that are relaxed much later. They're in order to get the argument going. And you very often see that indicated in Marx's writing. This is how we're going to deal with this for the moment. This is an assumption we will relax later, and so forth. And my argument is, towards the end of volume 3, which of course was completed before volume 1, third edition was completed, there are things happening there that are important. So I think that's important. In terms of the substantive versus formal analysis, I have a slightly different reading, which is that Gramsci was interested in production. That does not mean there is no production. So householding is self-sufficient production and then distribution within the household. So each of these forms of distribution have implications for how you think about production. But I think there's probably more than just an Aristotelian point about the substantive, because we want not to get bound up with trying to critique neoclassical economics, marginalism, Mengerism, and so forth, and want to deal with actually existing historical systems. I personally think his best work is on ancient markets and trade and so forth, the anthropological works, the Institute of Economy, which is, I think, really brilliant. Now, let me just move on to the question of how we might use Gramsci. There are two things one might refer to. One might refer to the Great Transformation, where Polanyi says classes are often far less important in terms of their impact on society than society is in terms of its impact on class interests. The only way you can get around that is for classes to seek allies, in terms of shared understandings of the societal interest. Polanyi seems to think there is a single societal interest we could agree on. Gramsci would certainly say you have to struggle to define the general interest, which also, of course, is the point that Marx and Engels make in the German ideology about how you become a hegemonic class. What that has to do with counter-movement groups and so forth. Branchy is well aware there's hegemony, counter-hegemony, sub-hegemony. And in relation to our colleague over here, one of the major issues in Gramsci's work, he originally studied philology, or spatial and historical linguistics at university, and he was brought up as an Albanian minority in Sardinia, speaking Ardesh, which is an Albanian dialect. He spoke Sardinian, and then he went to Italy, and he's got a major problem of translation. And a large part of Gramsci's work is how you translate different sorts of ideas, different languages, different concepts between everyday life and more abstract analyses. And a key part of his whole analysis of the struggle for hegemony is the struggle over how to translate the sort of thing we've been talking about in terms of science into the everyday lives. So it has implications for class mobilization and the language that we might use in the academic community and the language we might do in terms of political mobilization is precisely in Gramsci in terms of problem of translation. And there's some fine work that's been done on traducibilità, translatability, as a key theme in Gramsci's work. Finally, in terms of wars of position and wars of maneuver, I would say that what we're looking at in terms of counter-movements is wars of maneuver, but they will only make sense if they're articulated together in terms of a broader war of position.
Yes, first let me start with the question to the double movement. My interpretation of the double movement is a little bit different from all what we heard yesterday, because in my understanding, the double movement is we have a struggle to conserve systems of social security which are not adequate to the developing markets. Yes, this is the speech about the Spinnenland system. Yes, and then the argument of Calpurnius that if the political forces try to conserve these systems of protection, the counter movement would be more radical. And this was the idea of find reasons for the rise of the fascist movements. So for me it's crystal clear that counter-movements can be nationalist, fascist, and so on. Yes, I think this is the idea of Capellani, and when we look at the contemporary capitalism and what happens from Trump to, the next country is the Netherlands and Wilders, and we have elections in France. And in Germany too, yes, it's a very dangerous situation, and this is, makes Polanyi very important, yes. But the double movement is a heuristic, not more. It's impossible to take it as a line to interpret the development of society and the struggles and the counter movements in future. It's impossible. So, it's also impossible to say this is we are on the point, on this point of the double movement. No, perhaps in the middle of the Weimar Republic or so. Yeah, that's impossible. Yes, if perhaps it was a failure that I made 2 days ago. Yes, in the discussion. That's impossible, and it's not helpful because there's only a single history and. There is no scheme we can put history inside. So this is very important. And a second comment. I think that what we have in most of the contemporary capitalisms of Europe is that we lost the category of class in the scientific discourse, but also in the everyday life discourse. And this is the reason why everybody now is reading the book of Didier Eribon, yes? It was a flop in France, yes? In I think, 2009 or 11, I don't know. Yes, nobody read the book. And then we have the German translation, and everybody reads the book, yes? Everybody. Or say, I have read the book. Why? It's Didier Eribon, and Didier Eribon, it's a scholar of Pierre Bourdieu, a member, former member of the research group of Pierre Bourdieu, and he describes as a homosexual why all members of his family who were communist voters in past now voting for the Front National, yes, and this is very inspiring. And one of his arguments is, and they have not the categories to interpret their own situation, and that's a failure, a mistake of the political left. Yes, this is, I think, a very important argument. Thank you.
And I think the very last word to
Cardi,
very brief, because of...
Very briefly, yes. Yes, I say that Marx and Polanyi complement each other, and then by this I mean that they need each other. For Marx, we have the entire drive of capital for expansion, the expansion of the market, the apparent requirement for endless accumulation of capital that eventually develops into the financialization, as I had called it. There is nothing like that in Polanyi. And if you read Polanyi without understanding the trajectory of capitalism and its expansionary nature, then people might think it's possible it leads to voluntaristic interpretations that anything is possible if you have the right policies, the right Keynesian solutions, or the right political agenda, then the markets can be countered and everything can be made right again. So I think the two are complementary. And finally, I would like to say I do think they begin from the same philosophic starting point. When my father was in England, he there arrived freshly published early writings of Marx, which he read to his Christian socialist friends. In translation, of course, he translated as he read into English, and I think there is a similarity of underlying philosophy having to do with the manner in which the machine and the industrial revolution alienates labor and turns people into one-dimensional creatures of just a labor force. And finally, I'd like to share with you a comment my mother wrote regarding the shock, the culture shock of arriving in England, then the richest country in the world, and finding the drab conditions of life of the English working class. And she said that in England, her husband Carl set down the root of a sacred hate for market society. I think this is true. I think in my father there is a strong moral condemnation of the kind of valuation that the market puts on people. And I think that this ultimately is something that people can well understand, that the kind of value that the market puts on certain kind of services and in millions, and the low value it puts on things of very much obviously higher social value, like taking care in care and education, is obvious, and that we have to find a way to communicate with people and to respect the last point that was made, that a lot of the discourse on the liberal left is not intelligible to an ordinary intelligent person, and we have to find ways to talk to people in simple language.
Yeah, thanks very much. Thank you for your questions, and I think we deserve a break now.